Pellegrino from the Pharrell Show is here. And it was through Lou that I met the next gentleman we're welcoming in on the phone line. I figured since we're going into a little bit of a slight, well, half a sports zone and half a rock and roll zone, we should bring Lou in. And we welcome to the phone line right now, live to our show, Kyle Turley, former offensive lineman for Saints, Rams,
and the Chiefs. Here, even though he doesn't like talking about the Chiefs years very much.
Oh, no?
No.
Okay. Kyle.
Drunk. How you doing, brother?
I got Lou in here, too, from Pharrell Show.
I know, Big Lou. My brother's from another mother, man.
What's up, Kyle?
Thanks for having me.
Oh, no problem.
Not that I was going to talk to you about the Chiefs, but he just said you don't like talking about the Chiefs. Why is that?
No, I don't mind talking about the Chiefs. they just weren't my best years. But they're two of my most proud years of being in the NFL, because I came back from a pretty bad back injury that everybody counted me out on. So, didn't make it through each season that I played there the last 2 years 100%. Played pretty much about half the season each one. But a great experience, and I got to meet Amar Hunt before he passed. And he was a great man. And then, just the Kansas City people, man, and it really helped me out in touring with my music and stuff.
What was the full span of time you played in the NFL, Kyle?
98 to 2007. Had that little interruption there with the back injury for a year and a half.
Right. I mean, and I was telling Lou, I mean, when he mentioned your name to me as being a fan of rock and roll and stuff, obviously, me being a huge NFL fan, the first thing that came to my mind, which probably something you're probably sick of talking about, but since I've never spoken to you about, is Lou, when I came in tonight and told Lou you were going to call in, he pulled it right up for me on YouTube, so I got to relive it a second ago. The notorious play when you were on the Saints against the Jets, which forever, whose helmet did you pull off? I forget.
Oh, man, idiots out there and on the defense, I guess that, I guess from what we've heard is a common thing in locker rooms on the defensive side of the ball, decided he was going to try to rip my quarterback's head off, and, I had to do my job. They paid me a bunch of money to protect that guy, so nobody else was. I stepped in, and you can see it live and in color on YouTube and be the 250,168
viewers. Kyle, I got to tell you, man, I mean, listen, I'm as big of an NFL fan as I am my whole life. That play, I remember, and I mean, that's why as soon as Lou said your name, I mean, there's probably some offensive tackles over the years, he probably would have said your name to me, and I would have been like, yeah, I kind of remember that guy. As soon as he said to me, Kyle Turley, I mean, that immediately went to my mind, and I remember sitting on, because it was against the Jets, and I've lived in the New York area my whole life, so their games are always on TV. Even though I'm a Giant fan, I've got to watch the Jets, you know, as the other game in the other window, and I remember me and my friends literally getting up off the sofa and just ready to run through a fucking wall when we saw you do that, man. It was the greatest thing I've ever seen.
You're right. Well, like I said, I was doing my job. I took it to an extreme level, and, when everything was just kind of in a whole other world is what I call it, because it literally was in slow motion for me. And, it was just one of those moments of sports, man. And, I came out and became that guy that threw the helmet. And,
It was like a Viking moment. It was just like, it's everything that you get fired up about football, because more than anything, the guys I've always loved in football are the guys that have a fire and a passion that comes through when they play. And that's what I love so much about it. Obviously, I didn't want to see you rip a guy's head off, but I love the fact
exactly. Well, I tried.
I know, but I love that though. I mean, but I just, it just shows what you said. I mean, here you are, you got your quarterback's back, and if you watch the thing on YouTube, I mean, you know, you're not letting it go. You're gonna, you know, you've got to come out there with some sort of trophy, and if it's not the guy's head, you add his helmet. It was awesome, man. And I'll tell you, I love it to this day. I thought
he broke his neck. It was Aaron Brooks was the quarterback, and he let out this shriek that I'd never heard on a football field ever before in my life up to that point. And I thought for sure the way he was twisting that kid's head, man, that he broke his neck and or his back or something. Just if you watch the replay, you could see how his bent back and twisted all kinds of ways like a pretzel. And I just said, I just snapped because nobody was doing anything, and that guy just kept doing it and wouldn't let go of his face mask, twisting his head back. And like I said, that was instilled in me from a young age that that was my job to protect that guy. And I thought when that scream came out that it was over for him. And I said, you know what, if it's over for him, then it's going to be over for this guy, too. And, you know.
Who was the guy?
Damian Robinson of the Jets.
And have you talked to Damian Robinson since, after the years that have gone by? Did you guys exchange Christmas cards or anything?
No. Actually, I was with the Rams, and one of my other teammates, Fred Weary, defensive back, he I guess knew him or something after the game, was talking to him, and I passed by, and I was like, great game, Freddie. And he said, hey, Freddie. Or he said, hey, Kyle, this Damian Robinson. And I turned and looked. I didn't know he had gotten traded to the team we were playing against at that time. It was not the Jets. And I went over to him, and I said, you owe me $25,000, motherfucker. Don't ever think I'll forget that.
Oh, man. Listen, I mean, I hate to just dwell on that one play because you had a great career. And, I mean, you know, obviously playing for three teams and all that. I mean, but I just, to me, it's, you know, that's the stuff. Those guys like you and your spirit and you know, the passion you have for the game and your job is what my favorite players in the NFL. I mean, I'm a lifelong Giants fan, and I mean, I know people, you know, Brandon Jacobs had his critics the last few years, but I miss him like crazy because he was one of those guys. You know, he was a fireball, man. He would say stuff, and even though he didn't always have great games, he bought it on the field. He brought some intensity. Well, I love that.
Well, Kyle also had Joe Horn, so he knew what that was like playing with a guy with, you know, kind of a big mouth and a reputation on the field for being a character.
Yeah, I mean, Brandon Jacobs getting in Rex Ryan's face last year, I mean, that's beyond great. He needs to shut his mouth, and I love that shit.
Yeah, that's good.
Kyle,
it's entertainment. You got to go out and do your job, man, and that's what it's about. That's all what it was about for me. It was going out there making sure that those people sitting in the stands got their money's worth out of me for doing my job, you know. In that situation, it was definitely unique, and after that, it changed everything about who I was, you know, in the public side. So it's been a double-edged sword, but for the most part, man, you know, I guess people just saw it that I was real. It was genuine. It wasn't contrived. It wasn't preconceived. It was, you know, jerk reaction that this is my job. I have to step in and do this. And, you know, it's carried over into other aspects of what I'm doing with my charity work with the retired football players and going to bat with the NFL and, you know, protecting my teammates. You know, that was my job. That was the badge I wore as an offensive lineman, and I'm not taking that off, that's for sure.
Well, I want to ask you about that stuff, and we will move on to talk about other things. But the last thing I want to ask you about your years is at playing, and that particular play is that's what 2001 that happened in. So that's 11 years ago.
Yeah.
Did were you penalized or did you get a fine or anything for that?
Yeah, $25,000 they fined me, and I was lucky it was under Paul Tagliabue and not our guy now, man. I would have been probably kicked out of the league for sure, you know.
That's exactly where I was going. If you did something like that now, you probably would have been facing a few game suspension, right?
Oh, at least. You know, they were calling for it back then. It was just by the grace of God that after Paul Tagliabue was at the game, and after the game, he was questioned immediately by the media, and he said, you know, he gave me some props. He said, Kyle Turley is one of our best players, and, you know, everybody has their moment. And they said, well, what do you expect to happen to Kyle next week? And he said, and was quoted in the paper as saying, we expect him to be out there on the field helping his team win next Sunday.
Nice.
And so it was because Gene Washington and the guys that control all the fines and suspensions and all that, at the time, they wanted my head because they hated me, I guess, for some reason. And, you know, because I was always going at them with the union stuff and, you know, always speaking my mind about what they're not doing, you know, and taking money from players all the time. So, yeah, it was lucky that was the year that I had it and not nowadays because I would have been gone for sure.
Amazing. Well, it's we're talking live with Kyle Turley, former NFL player with, as we mentioned, the Saints, the Rams, the Chiefs. And, Kyle, I could talk to you forever about football, but I know that you've got a gig tonight, and you're calling because you are a big rock and roll fan. You've got your own band simply called Turley, and you sent me some stuff, and it really sounds good, man. It's kind of like a cross between there's some a country and southern vibe at times to it, and then obviously there's a hard rock vibe. Is that the two worlds that you love the most?
Yeah, man. I mean, that's how I grew up. You know, my old man was a trucker, a farmer, and, you know, for pretty much half my life till I was 10, I mean, he kept trucking when we moved to Southern California. But I grew up out west and farmlands and ranches and, you know, the old school country and southern rock, you know, here and there. My mom was from Southern California. We moved there when I was 10, and then I grew up in an unbelievable era of music out there in Southern California in the, you know, 80s and the 90s that, you know, erupted everything. And so I just had so many stations to listen to on the radio. It's like having Sirius XM radio, you know, living in Southern California. You just turn the station and bam, 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 all these great stations lining up with all this new music from hip-hop to metal to, you know, reggae and R&B and everything underneath the country. And I grew up listening to pretty much everything. Metal was the biggest love that I had. You know, you and I share that both. That was something that drove me to be, you know, especially on the football field, the person and the player that I was. I mean, Slayer and Pantera were, you know, that was my playlist. South of Heaven was my pregame song, and there was nothing that could stop me if I listened to that and went out on the football field. So I, you know, went to Nashville after I was done and just balled it all up into one and regurgitated it out on a microphone and put my band together. And, you know, here we are 3.5 years later. We're about 250 gigs in across the country, almost 200 different venues, and we toured with Hank 3 and played with Lynyrd Skynyrd and George Jones and Kansas and all these crazy folks, man. And it's, you know, I'm just putting the same dedication into this music thing that I did in football, and it's coming over pretty well with the people.
Yeah, well, it definitely sounds like, you know, you could certainly tour with a wide variety of people with the type of music that you're making, because it does touch on a lot of different sort of influences that you can hear throughout it. And when you go out and do this, Kyle, I mean, you're going out, and obviously you made some money in the NFL, so, I mean, I'm sure you're putting some of that into it, but is this really kind of a do-it-yourself thing? I mean, are you going out there and basically putting everything on the line in terms of your time and your finances and your resources to do this? Is this your main passion now, being retired from football?
Oh, yeah, but, I started this back when I was playing ball. I started my label, Gridiron Records, in 2006. We signed a few artists, some punk thrash bands out of Southern California, a new metal band and an alternative act, and was working with Nick Adler, runs the Roxy, and a buddy of mine, Mikey Dolan, used to play guitar in Soulfly and Snot. And we put this record label together, and we gave it a run, threw a lot of money, made a lot of mistakes, and learned from them. And when I was done, I just put a full force into what I was doing. We made some good connections over those years, and you know, now I'm starting to access those over this last few years that I've been doing this, and things are going well. I put everything I have into what I'm doing. You know, I don't believe in the stock market and Wall Street, and obviously, I took a hit like everybody else, because I believed in there ain't no man if you don't own no land deal, and unfortunately, that land became worth nothing for the most part. So I got struck by the economy like everybody else did, I think. But, you know, I'm out here. I've invested my money in my own personal bus, but I'm the driver. And this has been the first time in 3 years that I've had a merch guy with me. So, you know, I've been hustling this thing and grinding it out, earning my stripes, because I don't want anybody to ever say that it was because you made millions of dollars and you played in the NFL and that's why you made it in the music world too. I've sold and charted and done all these things with my records so far because of my hard work and getting out there and grinding this thing out. So I appreciate you giving me the time to talk about it, man. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. I know Lou had a question
for you. Well, I was just going to say that because we play Kyle's music on the Pharrell Show a lot, and one of these things about athletes and music, you know, you see it here, where there's certain channels that parade NBA players in who have music out, and they're rappers, and they're terrible, and they can't put sentences together on Twitter, so how are they going to put a rap album together, or a rap CD, or a rap song together? And then you look at Kyle, and Kyle, not because you're my friend, and not because we're tight, but you listen to Kyle's guitar playing, you listen to the lyrics, you listen, Kyle actually gives a shit. Kyle's not going to go into the studio and put something down that's terrible. He's going to walk in and give it his all, like he did on the football field, like he did when he was in the weight room, when he was at college playing, you know, for San Diego State and doing all these things. And you listen to Kyle, and you hear the passion in his voice when he talks about it. He doesn't put out garbage, and that's the thing I like about it. You wouldn't even think that Kyle Turley is a former offensive lineman in the NFL. You would think Kyle Turley's a huge music fan who just wants to put out music and has aligned himself with the right people.
Well, Kyle, what portion of the audience that comes out and sees your live gigs are NFL fans and former NFL or fans of you when you played versus people that are just there because they want to see Turley and they just know you as the rock guy or, you know, as the music guy?
Yeah, it's here and there. You know, I mean, again, we've had great opportunities to tour with some great people, you know, like Hank 3 and David Allen Coe, and open up for big artists. So, you know, we surprise a lot of folks. They don't know exactly that this is Turley the football player, too, you know. So, but those that do come out mostly to our, you know, personal shows that we've booked, like we're out on this West Coast run right now, and this is all me booking it on my own and going and showing up. You know, it is the football fans, you know, the majority of the people that do show up. And the rest are just people off the street and other people from the local bands that we have that open for us. And we've got a tremendous response. I mean, there's nothing I can say more than, you know, we've been hitting the Billboard charts and, you know, with the Heatseeker chart that they have out there for up-and-coming artists. And, you know, it all just speaks for itself, man. And, you know, it's one of those things. I'm putting the same passion that I did at football into what I'm doing my music. It's not something I just picked up. Music's been there. Picked up a guitar when I was 14, crossing the border of Mexico on a surf trip, and I still have that guitar with me today. And, you know, football just became its own thing for me. I was just phenomenally good at it from the start, I guess. I only played my senior year of high school, and it just took on its own thing. And I just went with it, dedicated myself to it, and I'm doing the same with the music. And, you know, you got to earn that shit, man. You can't just go out there and, you know, start a record label and get some artists. I learned that the hard way, you know, blew a bunch of money. And I'm seeing the benefits now of hard work, dedication, and that is what pays off in the music world more so than any of this stuff that's out there. It's getting in front of those fans and making them count each and every city and returning year in and year out. I mean, I've learned that from the best.
Well, I'll tell you what, there's a guy that just walked into my studio. Lou just walked out, and this guy just walked in who can certainly attest to what you're saying, because he built a metal record label 30 years ago that's one of the few labels still thriving, and that's my old friend Brian Slagle from Metal Blade who just walked in. And,
hell yeah.
It's like a Kyle Turley, this is your life moment in here.
Hey, man, how you doing?
Oh, my God, man. Sign us, please. We need country labels. I go into these country labels in Nashville and Sony and Columbia, and I've had these showcases and stuff, you know, and invite them out. And you go out there, and they listen to you, and you kill it, you have a good show, and then they invite you to the offices, and you go over there, and the first thing that comes out of their mouth is like, "Oh, we'd like to put you with this writer and that writer and blah, blah, blah." I'm like, "Motherfucker, these are my songs. This is what's inside of me. This is how I had no idea until I moved to Nashville that all these people out there didn't write their own music. I grew up listening to Slayer, Pantera, Snot, all these huge bands of, you know, metal and the rock world. And everybody, it was unique and personal to all these people. And then I got to Nashville, and it's so fake. So I'm trying to break out, man, and find somebody that'll even listen to us and know that I'm a guy that'll be out there grinding for you."
Yeah, I haven't heard any of the newer stuff, but I've heard some of the older stuff. It's actually pretty good, man.
You know, Kyle, one of the things along that basis of what you're saying is true, because, you know, I'm looking at this. I mean, these are all songs that you wrote. I mean, yourself. I mean, you are the sole writer on this stuff. I mean, that is rare, because a guy like you, an ex-athlete or whatever, you know, you'd find a bunch of song doctors, some people, or maybe do a bunch of covers or whatever. But this really is it's obviously there's a lot of heart and soul coming from you on this. And when did you start writing songs? I mean, because to me, as a music fan, I don't play any instruments and I don't perform and I can't sing, I can't do anything. But I've dedicated my life to helping get the word out about the music that I love. But I look at it and I see you can find a million great guitar players anywhere, a million great drummers, bass players. Go to any guitar center in the country, you see guys that play circles around people, blow your mind. To me, I've always been amazed and most impressed by the ability for people to write great songs, to write, you know, to write complete songs. And you've done that. When did you know you had that talent? When did you first start writing?
You know, I always was dabbling in it, and so, you know, poetry, and my grandmother was a published poet, and she was from Mobile, Alabama. You know, she grew up in an unbelievable era of time where, you know, we didn't have anything, man. And so, you know, sitting and talking to her over the years growing up and reading some of her stuff, you know, it just intrigued me to, you know, learn how to put words together and tell a story that comes from inside of you and that people can feel, you know, and listening to old school country artists, you know, there's nothing better than making the people feel what you feel inside. When you play a show and when you sing a song and you see tears in people's eyes, or you, the elation and the cheering and everything, because they know what that song means, coming from you, from your passion on stage, there's nothing better, man. I mean, playing the NFL was fun, but you know, the songwriting thing has been a work of progress for me over years, as it has for a lot of people. I just, you know, it's something that I just naturally kept doing and getting better at. And then, you know, moving to Nashville, I got a buddy of mine that is a producer out there, and he's, I've known him for like 12, 15 years. And he's recording records, so he helped me out, learn how to structure some certain things, and you know, there's some mathematics to that, and just like football, I just started picking up all these little things, and before I knew it, I was a songwriter, and you know, before I knew it, I was a bus driver after, you know, watching the guy drive all the buses and take some lessons and stuff. Before I bought my own and came out on the road and hit it hard, you know, I'm too old and got too many injuries to be riding around in a van. And I did make some nickels, so I put it where I felt I wanted it to be. And, you know, so now I know how to service generators on buses and change oils and do all that. But, you know, it's crazy. You put your mind to something, you'd be surprised what you could do.
Well, listen, man, it's great talking to you, and I really appreciate where you're coming from. And as I said, being a lifelong NFL fan and also being a lifelong, obviously, rock music fan, it's cool to see you put this together. I mean, I'm approached by a lot of people that, you know, do bands and try to do this, but I can tell that this is really coming from your heart, and this is really, you know, you're seriously dedicated to this, which, you know, a lot of guys do it as a hobby, and that's fine, too. But this is obviously coming from a different place, and I wish you the best of luck with it. People can go to KyleTurley.com to learn more about what Kyle's doing. KyleTurley.com. Are you on Twitter too?
Yes, I am at Kyle Turley on Twitter.
Easy enough, so you can do that. And you're out on the road now. Are there any immediate dates you want to plug?
Oh yeah, man. Well, we're in Bakersfield tonight, and we're in LA on Thursday night. We're headlining at the Whiskey. Really love everybody to come out to that show. It's in L.A., and then we're down in Huntington Beach on Friday at Fitzgerald's, and then out in Palm Desert at Hood on Saturday. And then we're taking a week break. I'm going to fly home, see the family, and then get back on the road, and we got to head it up Arizona, Utah, Denver, on our way back to Nashville, man. We got a bunch of stops. It's all on KyleTurley.com. You can check out our tour.
We got people listening all over the U.S., so that's the best way to find out. And anything from you, Brian, before we let Kyle go?
I'm not going to be in L.A., unfortunately, for the Whiskey Show, but I'll have some of the staff come out and definitely check it out, man.
Hey, I appreciate it, brother. I'm a big fan. You don't know what you did for the metal industry. I know that people tell you all the time, but it's unreal what you were able to do in bringing that music to the masses, man, especially in that era. And you and everybody else, I have to thank for a lot of motivation that gave me out there on the football field to go out there and do what I did. because of those lyrics, those music guys, the people I knew was real, and I it just it's something. If it's real, it just makes you 10 feet tall and bulletproof. It's something like that in metal. And I appreciate you guys having me on. Thank you so much.
Yeah, absolutely, man. And hey, while you're saying this real quick, what was your first concert? What was your first metal concert, Kyle?
My first metal show was, probably when I was in San Diego. I was working security up at the front, man, and Rollins came through. I didn't get the opportunity. We didn't have much money to go out. My friends were going to all the Ozfests, and the things that just got cranked up. But when I got to New Orleans, that's when it opened up for me, and I finally had money, man, and I made sure I was hanging out backstage with Phil and the boys and Pantera, and sitting in the back of the bus, getting down with Tom O'Reilly and all those guys with Slayer, man.
Sure.
Unbelievable opportunities, man.
Well, good stuff, man. It's always great to talk to you. Have a good gig tonight and safe travels out there. And I'll play a track as I let you go. I'll play a track from the what you sent me here, Death, Drugs, and Double Cross. Now, this show and my show being known for the hard rock stuff, what track do you want people to hear so they get an idea what you're all about?
I mean, Death, Drugs, and the Double Cross is a great track. We wrote that one, I did for Lynyrd Skynyrd and the whole, plane crash and everything that evolved around that. You know, you'll hear it in my music. I'm trying to make a resurgence of Southern Rock. I think that everything has its time and it's coming back around, and Southern Rock is something I really want to come back. So you can hear that one, or you can go to KyleTurley.com and get a song called We Ride for Free. And that's another great representation, but we've got a new record coming out later this year, and there's some heavier stuff on it that I know you're going to dig. I'll get it to you as soon as possible.
Well, I can play, I have We Ride on this disc too, so I can do that one if that's the one you want to do, that people can get on your site.
Yeah, that'd be killer, man, because that song right there, people can get that for free, so listen to it, and you ain't got to pay nothing for it.
And I'll tell you what, man, I agree with you, what you said about Southern Rock. I mean, look at what Skynyrd's doing, which obviously now Skynyrd is still great, down to, I think, one original member, if that, but they're still incredible. That music is so timeless. I mean, I love some of the early Blackfoot stuff, some of the Outlaw stuff, and the Molly Hatchet stuff. I mean, that music is timeless, man. It holds up forever. It never sounds out of date to me.
That's the truth, and it needs to come back. You know, there needs to be new bands out there that get to the level of those guys, because that's real music, man. True Southern Rock helped to heal our nation in many ways.
And those guys are still killing it. I saw both Lynyrd Skynyrd and Molly Hatchet at Hellfest in France in front of 35,000 people, and they were both phenomenal. Blew me away by how good both bands were. Awesome.
Well, listen, man, I know you got a gig, so I'll let you fly, Kyle, and we'll talk to you soon, man. Hopefully we'll hook up one of these days, all right?
Man, thank you guys so much. I really appreciate it, Chunk, and with each fan, the whole band is. Maybe sometime we'll get on the TMS, man. My bass player will stump you. He's a sunken treasure chest of worthless knowledge.
Well, that's kind of what I made a career out of being, so we'll probably hit it off.
Yeah, you're right. All right, brother, who dat?
All right, man.
I'll talk to you soon.
See
Thanks,
you, Kyle.
Appreciate you, brother.
You got it. There he goes. Kyle Turley, former NFL star. I could have talked to him the whole time about football, of course, and obviously his what he's doing now, which is this band simply called Turley. Let's play a track from it right now. It's Eddie Trunk. We are live on Sirius XM 39 until 10 o'clock Eastern. It's called We Ride.
Thank you. day from the insane.
Close. Trump Nation on Sirius XM's Hair Nation.